Welcome to Empowered Kids TV and welcome to Village Talk. I am so excited to have you here. You're here because you know that every family has the potential to be great and you're willing to push the boundaries of your mindset so that you can create the family of your dreams. Today, we welcome back Sue DeCaro. Sue is an amazing heart-centered coach that helps parents create more harmony and connectedness through boundaries, discipline, and confidence. A mom of two, she has helped families take advantage of their strengths to reshape family interactions in a positive way. Sue's training as a parent coach combined with her own family's experience enables her to approach every client with empathy, and you can really feel Sue's empathy, and to craft a tailored approach to achieve their goals. Sue's mission is to help bring more laughter, more love, and more enjoyment to our families. You can learn more about Sue's amazing work at decaroparentcoaching.com. Sue, welcome back to the village.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here.
All right. We're going to dive straight into today's question. This question comes from Marissa, and Marissa writes, should I be talking to my 13-year-old about porn? I'm concerned that the other boys in school may be starting to talk about it, and I don't want them to be the ones telling him about porn. Do you have any advice on what I should say that helps him understand and helps him stay safe?
Porn is a subject that many parents wonder about, and I'm thrilled, I think, Marissa, that you brought this up. And in your question was the word should. Mm-hmm. And we've talked a lot in the past about the word should, because I think it's important to separate that word from your values and what you think is important in a discussion with your son. So, you know, porn is something that is out there. And I can remember when my kids were young, and I don't remember the age, but my daughter coming home laughing hysterically that they had been over another friend's house and they typed in the word boobs by accident. And, you know, up came, I don't even know what, I don't even want to imagine what, but they were laughing when they came home, and oh my gosh, you wouldn't believe what happened, Mom. And then they told me, and I was probably like wide-eyed, trying to figure out what to say, because it is tough to navigate this, especially on the spot when something comes up. But our kids are probably landing on the wrong site. Your children may be landing on the wrong site. And I think one of the most important parts of having these challenging conversations about things that are hard to talk about is to create open space with our children to talk about anything. And when you have that open space where you've talked about sexuality, you know, you've talked about what we call the birds and the bees, and you have modeled, you know, healthy sexual expression and love, and, you know, and I mean like hugging and kissing, I don't mean, you know, making love in front of your children, you know, your kids start to understand that they can come to you and talk with you about anything. And so, you know, if it sounds like you're talking about boys, and if you think your boys may be exposed to it with others, you know, there isn't anything you can do. I mean, some kids as young as 9 have been on the internet curious and, you know, may have typed in boobs by accident and had a field day because kids are curious. And I think it's really important to keep out of the realm of shame when we're talking about natural curiosity. We don't want to bring judgment or shame to the fact that our children are naturally curious. And, you know, if they type, I'm just continuing with this, this example, when they type the word boob by accident and things come up, that, you know, it was an accident, number one, but it also was an education. And so when they bring it to you, that's the chance where you can really expand upon what is out there on the internet and how important it is to really look at the content and be sure that we are setting healthy boundaries with our children and why porn, you know, maybe even exists and why it's not a healthy way to experience, let's call it our sexuality. And that's where it opens the door to talk about sexuality, sexual pleasure, you know, love, the things that are very difficult conversations because we're not used to it. many of us didn't have parents that sat around and talked openly about, you know, what sexual pleasure or love was. And so, you know, I learned from friends. And I couldn't come back and have more of a description or honest communication with my family because that just wasn't done. And so I think you really need to tap into your values and think about whether it's important for you to open the dialogue or wait for the dialogue to be open. And in that respect, I would make sure that you work on your connection with your children and your family, that they can come to you, Marissa, with anything that they want to discuss or need help with or need help understanding, so that if they are experiencing something with other children or somebody showed them something or shared something with them, they can come home to you and say, guess what just happened? And you can help them to understand more about their own sexuality and why this is not a healthy realm of, let's call it sexual pleasure for whoever might be watching the porn. It's not real love. And I think we need to point that out, that these are movies. These are movies in the making that are trying to sell, you know, to those people who might desperately need that type of loving connection, or that it's not really a loving connection, that type of pleasure that's fake. It's fake. It's not real life reality of having a loving partner. And so that's where explaining to your children what an intimate relationship looks like, what love is about, and, you know, healthy boundaries around sexuality is important. I think it's really important.
I love it. There's one thing you touched on that I want to pick up on, and that's having this conversation without the judgment and the shame. There is one case where I knew of a family, and a little boy, I think he might have been about 13 or 14 at the time, and he was at a friend's house, and the friend had a text message that showed pornographic images, and you could then reply to this text message to get more. And obviously it was a premium text, so each time you sent a text message and a picture came back, you paid a price for it. Oh. And I think he got so caught up in that, he ran a bill up of like hundreds and hundreds just texting. But it was the shame of being able to talk about it. And obviously it came out because the bill came home and his parents was like, what is this bill for? And his expression to his mom was he couldn't help himself. Like the more he saw, the more he was curious and he wanted to see. But he was so then ashamed that he had clicked to see more that he couldn't get himself out of the cycle. And I think if we leave that space where our kids could come and talk to us, even when they feel ashamed of their own actions, that they know they can come to us and don't get added shame or judgment piled upon them, then we leave the room to give them guidance in the times when it really matters.
I think that's such an important story. And I think it happens more than we know. I mean, it happened to my own daughter. And the power that this had over her and the shame were so, I mean, it's powerful, the connection, the curiosity, and the what they're seeing, because they don't know any better. Or they may, but they get caught up in the powerful, you know, play of it all. And so it's very hard as a parent when your child comes to you or you find out your child is involved in this, because we really have to help them to learn a different way of engaging with who they are, their own sexual curiosity, and how that can play out in the world without getting into, you know, the world of porn, so to speak. And so I think, you know, the judgment is a really huge part to leave on the sidelines. I mean, we don't really want to judge our kids in any way, because judgment brings shame and shame disconnects. And so if you have judgment and shame, you've now created a wedge between you and your child, and your child's not going to come to you with many things for you to help them, especially the more difficult and challenging things. So the more open we are and neutral and it may be hard. You may have to go away from that conversation and come back. You may have to say, I would love to talk with you about this, but you know what? Do you mind if we talk a little later? Because I need to think about how I want to share and discuss this with you. Not, you know, not because you're in trouble, just because I need to tap into my own knowledge to be able to share helpfully with you.
I love that. And I'm going to recap because I think we've got some really amazing tips from Marissa. The first was leave out the shoulds. Leave out the shoulds and the noise from everyone else and what should happen, and really navigate through this process looking at your own values and what you want for your family. Create space so that you can talk to your kids about anything, not just this topic, but a space that allows your kids to feel safe, that they can explore and talk to you. And model what healthy sexuality looks like in terms of loving relationships. Keep out the judgment and the shame. We've talked about how important that is. Set healthy boundaries and talk about why they exist. Talk about why porn exists as an activity to begin with. And why not may not be the most healthy model of a loving sexual relationship that they should rely on. And work on our connection, because the deeper our connection, the easier it is for our kids to be able to come and discuss a whole range of topics that might be difficult, including this one. And I think I love that you're saying this conversation can happen in one of two ways. It could be prompted from our kids, or we can look at our own values within our family and decide if this is a proactive conversation that we're going to have in order to be able to set our kids up with some guidance. Is there anything else you'd like to add, Sue?
You know, I think one thing I want to add in hearing the recap is that the judgment and shame is not necessarily something we can just, you know, let me brush off any judgment or shame I might have. So judgment and shame sometimes takes work to deconstruct where your shame or your judgment might be coming from your own conditioning, your own family of origin, your own upbringing. And, you know, it is what it is, but if you, I didn't want to give the impression that it's just easy to put our judgment and shame on the sidelines and come to these conversations, because it's not. I think it's something that takes some work and some inner work, really, to say, where does this judgment and shame come from? Where did it originate? And how can I deconstruct that so I can connect more deeply with myself without judgment and shame on these topics, and then connect more deeply with my child? So it's a process. So don't, you know, I didn't want to make light of that, because I think it's important to acknowledge that it takes work.
I love that, and it's amazing. And just to remind everybody, the best place you can get work and support in terms of being able to deconstruct some of those beliefs is to reach out to Sue and her amazing work at decaroparentcoaching.com. So I want to say thank you so much for joining us and for helping us with Marissa's question.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All right. With love and gratitude and powers, until next time. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Village Talk. Now remember, it still takes a village. So if you found value in this episode, be sure to like it and share it with your family and friends. And if you haven't already, please do subscribe and hit that bell icon so that we can notify you of our upcoming episodes. Remember, as we always say in this village, you're just one connection away. Until next time, Empowerers, with love and gratitude from all of us at Empowered Kids TV.